Well, good morning and welcome to Harvest on this summer Sunday, this patriotic Sunday. Jordan just said, should we do the Pledge of Allegiance? I think we will pass on that and we will dig into God's Word together. You know that we are in a summer series called Unsung, Everyday People, Uncommon Faith. Last week, we started the series talking about faith. What is faith? The Bible gives us a definition of faith in Hebrews 11:1. It says this, that faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, that faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things unseen. That faith is not limited to having an assertion to some theological statements, but faith is a lifestyle. That faith isn't just biblical doctrine, faith is biblical living, that we are called to live a life of faith. Hebrews 10:38 says that the righteous shall live by faith. Hebrews 11:6 says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so this summer, we are digging into having increased uncommon faith. And we're doing so by looking at some everyday characters. Everyday people like me, like you. I don't know about you, but I feel very ordinary. How many of you feel very ordinary? I do. I just feel ordinary. But I take great comfort and encouragement that when you look in the pages of Scripture, that God often uses ordinary people to do amazing things. And so we're going to look at ordinary people, because the reality is that God's ability to use me is not based on my ability. That God's ability to use you is not based on your ability, but it's based on your availability of his ability through you. And today in the passage, we're going to look at four dudes, four just everyday guys who God uses because they are available. If you have God's Word, I encourage you to open it up to Mark chapter 2. And in Mark chapter 2, we're going to see this story of how God is using everyday guys. The book of Mark is written by Mark. Mark would have been an eyewitness to this event that's going to unfold in front of us. But the Holy Spirit would be guiding him to write the words that would be preserved in the Bible that we have today. And I find it very interesting that Mark and the Holy Spirit through Mark, they don't even identify the names of the guys. The guys are unknown by name, but they are known by their faith. They are known by their relentless faith. That's the title of the message today, Relentless Faith. And when I think about relentless faith, I'm thinking about a faith that is persistent, a faith that is determined, a faith that does not give up. Why don't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, it's by faith that we come to you, believing that you exist and knowing that you are a rewarder of those who seek you. And so, God, we are seeking you this morning through the pages of your word. God, would you speak to us through your word? God, would you increase our faith? Would you give us an uncommon faith? Would you give us a faith that is relentless, faith that is persistent. Give us eyes to see people as you see them as a result of our time together in your word this morning. We pray this in the name of Jesus, the one that we love. Amen. If you're taking notes, I encourage you to jot down the first point. The first point is this, is that relentless faith takes action. Relentless faith takes action. Well, let's read the story together, starting in verse 1. And when he, Jesus, returned to Capernaum. Capernaum is a town in Galilee. It's at the northern end of the Sea of Galilee, and Jesus is returning back home. And he comes back to Capernaum, and after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So word is getting out to the people that Jesus is in town. And many gathered, verse 2, together, so that there was no more room in this house, not even at the door. And what is Jesus doing? Why are all the people gathered there? And he was preaching the word to them. No doubt there would be a collection of people that were there, certainly people that would have believed that Jesus was the Messiah, the Son of God. No doubt there would have been people who were curious, who is this Jesus? What is he all about? What are the things that he is saying? But it's interesting to me that in this passage, the only group of people that he references would be the scribes, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, the religious elites. And we're going to see how they play out later on in the story. And so the house is packed with people. People know that he's in town. Notice verse 3, and they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. We don't know if this man's paralysis is by birth or by injury, but we do know this, is that God loved the paralytic. God loves the paralytic because God loves everyone. God's love is indiscriminate, and so should our love be as believers. That our love should not be discriminate in any way, not based on race or age or socioeconomic status or by gender or by physical ability. That as believers in Jesus Christ, that we have received the love of Jesus, and the love of Jesus is inside of us, that we should be the most compassionate, kind, caring, loving people on the planet, especially to those who have a disability. Amen? That as believers in Christ, we should not have in our vocabulary any slangs or any derogatory words that would reference those with a disability, or what I would prefer to call those who are differently abled. Never, never should flow from our mouths. Retard. Invalid. Deformed. Or any other term like that. These are precious people, loved by God. And we ought to love them as well. So never should we use slang words. Never should we joke about people who are differently abled. I love it that we're a church and we have people in our church with different abilities. Oh, that we would be a church that would be like Jesus, and that we would welcome and care for people like this. And so this is what's happening, is that God brings into the lives of these four guys, he brings in this paralytic. Sometimes God brings people into our lives, not just so that we can help them, but that they can help us. Have you ever noticed that before? That God brings people into our lives, not just so that we can help them, but they can help us. Do you know what the number one PGA Professional Golf Association video is? The number one most watched video. It's not of Tiger Woods. It's not of Rory McIlroy. It's not of Jack Nicklaus or any of the great golfers. In fact, it's a video of a gal named Amy Bockerset. She is a 20-year-old golfer out of Arizona who has Down syndrome. We were introduced to her in a public kind of a way just in January of this year. Is that Gary Woodland, a PGA golfer, was in a tournament down in Arizona, and she played a hole with him. It was a par 3, hole number 16. And she got up to the tee, and as she was coming up to the tee, she just said, she's like, I got this. And she swings her club and hits the ball, and the ball goes into a sand bunker. And as they walk up to the sand bunker, Gary Woodland says to her, do you want me to get the ball out for you? And she's like, no, I got this. And with another swing of her sand wedge, she hits the ball up onto the green 10 feet from the pin. She walks to the pin, or to the ball that's near the pin, and she's like, I got this. And she puts the ball in, and the crowd just cheered. And the video is now seen by tens of millions of people. Gary Woodland went on to win the U.S. Open just a few weekends ago on Father's Day weekend. As he was presented the trophy for winning the U.S. Open, a major golf tournament, he took the time to FaceTime his friend Amy that he had met just months before. Because Amy was in his mind and thinking all along the way as he hit different challenges on that course, he's thinking, I got this. Just like she was an inspiration to him. And so oftentimes God brings different people into our lives, not just so we can help them, but they can help us. And God brought into these four guys, he brought this paralytic. We don't know if they were friends or if they were strangers, but we do know this, is that they were filled with compassion and they were filled with faith, because they knew that Jesus was the only one who could save and help and heal him. And so they together brought him to Jesus. And so in the text here, we see that it was a group effort, that they did something that they couldn't do individually, but they did it together, that they carried him. A few weeks ago, I heard about a guy in our church who was facing just some difficulties, some challenges, a difficult season in his life. And so I texted five guys in our church, and his challenges were that of physical and relational. They were for sure financial as well, and he needed to have some spiritual friends around him. Wasn't surprised at all that within an hour, all five guys texted back, eager to help, eager to do something together that maybe they couldn't do by themselves, but eager to do it together. What a great example of this picture, to carry one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. And so when you're aware of a need, when you see a need, whether the need is physical or relational or financial or spiritual, what is your first reaction? Is your first reaction to ignore or to look away, to think that it's someone else's issue? Is your first reaction to start to calculate and to assess what the inconvenience is to you? Or is your first reaction to see people and their problems as an obstacle for your own purposes in that day? I've often heard it said that parenting would be great if it wasn't for the kids. I have even said that. Parenting would be great if it wasn't for the kids, and because you're beginning to see people as an obstacle to things that you want to get done in that day. Or do you have eyes to see people, and are you eager to help? And so these guys, they see a need and they're eager to help, and they pick him up, and together they what? They carry him to Jesus. They physically carried him to Jesus. It wasn't like they just said, hey, did you hear that Jesus is in town? Hoping that he could somehow himself get there. They didn't just go to hang out with Jesus themselves and leave the paralytic behind, but they went and they got him and they carried him to Jesus. I've seen this modeled even this past week here at our church. This last week we had high five, and we had 388 kids and leaders in the building. Amazing amount of people that were here this past week, and we had so much fun together. I could not be more thankful for the leadership of Katie Mendoza and Bridget Patel in making this past week happen. I couldn't be more thankful for the amazing elective leaders who sacrificed time and energy and made each of these electives super creative and appealing to our kids, and they had just an amazing time. I wish you could have been here to see the joy in the kids' faces as they were a part of High Five. Next Sunday, we're going to celebrate High Five with a highlight video, and we're going to have kids on the platform. We're going to have snow cones out in the parking lot, so don't miss out on next week as we celebrate High Five. But I could not be more thankful for those in our church family. Families and kids who brought their neighbor, their classmate, their teammate to High Five. Did you know that over 50% of the kids that came to High Five this past week, 50% of the kids in that photo, don't call Harvest their church home, but they came because a friend invited them and a friend brought them. There's a story of a lady who is a mom, and there's another like single mom in her life who's going through just a difficult time. And so she has just recently taken in this little girl into her home, and she brought her to High Five. She texted me on Thursday this story. You're going to love it. She mentions the girl by name and says she had her first day of High Five today, and she came home and said it was the best day of her life. She kept talking about Jesus and how she loves him and had lots of questions for me. Before I read the Bible to both girls, to her daughter and to this other girl, it took us down the road from her questions about how you can get to heaven. She said that she wanted to accept Jesus and to love him and to be with him forever in heaven. So we prayed together and she accepted Jesus into her heart. It was amazing and so precious. I can't believe how quickly she was impacted. One day of High Five and no prior church or Jesus experience. Amen? That's worth celebrating, right? So you think about this mom who was willing to be inconvenienced, who was willing to allow another girl to come into her home and made herself available to the Lord, and think about what God has done through her and through that. We praise God for that. So a relentless faith is one that takes action. These four guys, they bring their paralyzed friend to Jesus, but they're going to face an obstacle. So jot this down. Relentless faith overcomes obstacles. Relentless faith overcomes obstacles. Verse 4, and when they could not get near him because of the crowd, why couldn't they get near him? Because of the crowd. So did the crowd not see the paralytic? Or worse yet, did the crowd see the paralytic and do nothing? It's easy to become comfortable in the crowd. It's easy to just look inward and not look outward. It's easy to do that even in a church. If you've been coming to Harvest for a while, coming to Harvest is pretty comfortable. You know the building, you know the people, you know where your exact seat is. And I can tell you where your seat is. I know who sits on the left and who sits on the right, and who sits on the aisle and who sits in the middle and who sits in the front and who sits in the back. And it's easy to come and just be comfortable. But what about those who would come into our church for the first time? Who would have a questioning heart or a lonely heart or a discouraged heart or a skeptical heart? What about those who come in and they don't know others? Oh, that we would be a church that would see the needs of others, and that we would be eager to minister to them, that we wouldn't just come to church to be served, but come to serve others. And I'm not saying this, that we need to all now sign up and be a part of the greeting team and get a lanyard and your name on it. That's not it. But that we would have a life of faith, and that we would look to see others in need. That we would be willing to give up our aisle seat if that would be best for someone else. That as we see a young mom who's pushing a stroller and is carrying a diaper bag and her Bible and is struggling, that we would take the time to help. That when we see someone standing alone, that we wouldn't just walk by, but we would say hello. And if we see that there's someone that's in need, that we would take the time to listen and take the time to pray. That we wouldn't be so comfortable in our own church and miss out on the opportunity to minister to others. A crowd that is focused on self can hinder others from coming to Christ. Oh, that wouldn't be the case of our church. And so they get to the house and they're crowded out. They can't get in because of the crowd. So then they get discouraged, right, and defeated, and they give up and they go home. Is that what happens? No, they overcome an obstacle. What do? They climb up on the roof and they remove the roof and they make an opening and they let down the bed that the paralytic lay on. Can you imagine that scene? Here they are, they're with Jesus and Jesus is teaching them and debris starts falling and this hole opens up in the roof and in drops this individual. And what an amazing scene that must have been. Rarely does life go according to plan, right? Rarely. Even in everyday life, there's obstacles. How many of you have ever done a house project and never finished the house project? You watch like these TV shows, and like in an hour, they like transform the whole house. Or you watch a show and they like cook something, and you just think that, that's so easy to do, and you start to cook it yourself, and it's like a disaster. And it's never as easy, it's never as quick, it's never as immediate as you think it's going to be. Now, this upcoming week, I'm planning on painting a couple of bathrooms in our house. And I know right now that it's not going to go as easy as I think. There's going to be paint all over. And it's going to be, as I'm doing the ceiling, it's going to drip on me and getting out all the tarps. I'm not going to have enough paint. I'm going to have to, like, go back to the store. And there's always obstacles along the way. There's always obstacles, not just in life, but there's obstacles in ministry. And as we seek to minister to people, it's never as easy as we think it's going to be. And sometimes the biggest obstacle we need to overcome is overcome that of fear. The fear of failure, the fear of the unknown, the fear of being rejected. A couple of years ago, I became aware of a man in our church who, his alcohol was destroying his life, so much so that his wife had moved out and his daughter in a healthy kind of a way because they needed separation. It just wasn't healthy for them to be in the house. And so I called up a couple of guys and we went over to see him. And as I am standing on his porch, I'm not sure that I'm full of faith. I'm full of fear. Like, what is going to happen here? Is he going to open up the door and welcome me into the house, or is he going to open up the door and welcome me with a shotgun and tell me to get out of his life and not be a part of anything that's going on with him? And instead, God worked through all of that, and he opened up the door. And then the next day, one of the individuals who had gone with me offered to take him to a rehab facility, and he voluntarily checked himself into a rehab facility, and he's been sober since that day. Praise God for that. And he's active in our church, and he's serving in High Five. And you think about obstacles. Think about the obstacles that these four men faced in Mark chapter 4, how easy it would have been to be like, oh, this isn't as easy as we thought it was going to be, and just kind of give up. Think about what the end of the story would have been. Think about the end of the story if we wouldn't have taken that effort. Think about in your own life times when you face difficulty rather than walking in faith and having relentless faith and overcoming obstacles. Oh, that God would give us a relentless faith that we would overcome obstacles. Even when I don't know the outcome, I know the one who controls the outcome. And for that, it's enough to act. And point number three is this, that relentless faith experiences God's power. Relentless faith experiences God's power. Verse 5, so they lowered the paralytic into the house, and when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." In an instant, he went from sinner to son. And only Jesus can save, but only Jesus is the only religious leader who even claims to be able to do that. Think about all the other world religions. It's all about doing things to earn God's favor. And Jesus, in an instant with grace, can forgive. Jesus can forgive you today, regardless of your past, regardless of your guilt, regardless of your shame and your regret. That Jesus can save you. It doesn't mean that you need to clean yourself up first. and then come to Jesus doesn't mean that you need to start going to church more or that you need to read your Bible more or attend a class. But Jesus in an instant can save you. That on the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." It's not about the things that we do to earn his favor, but it's what he has done and applying his forgiveness in our life. And his forgiveness is available to each and every one of you today. And so Jesus offers that forgiveness and says to him, "Your sins are forgiven." But notice verse 6, the scribes, the religious elite, they're sitting there. They're not rejoicing in the fact that his sins are forgiven. But they're saying, "Why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And the answer to that is, who can forgive sins but God alone? What's the answer? No one. But Jesus himself is claiming to be God, and they're not understanding that or wanting to believe that. And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they were questioning, he says to them, "Why are you questioning these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise, take up your bed and walk'?" What's easier? Well, of course it's easier to say your sins are forgiven if you don't really mean it. But if you really mean it, think about that. What's harder to do? It's for sure that. And so Jesus says, "So that you may know that the Son of Man has authority, so that you know that what I'm saying is true, because this man's sins are forgiven, to prove that, I'm going to say to this man, get up, rise, pick up your bed, and go home." So, can Jesus heal today? Can he? Does Jesus heal today? Yes, absolutely. If you've been tracking with me, we've been praying for my mom. My mom was diagnosed with cancer in September. In October, she had surgery. In November through March, she went through chemo and radiation. And she just had her six-month checkup just a week or so ago. And she is cancer-free, praise God. So much so that the doctor says, "You don't need to come for your next 3 months checkup. Just skip that. Just come and see me in 6 months." And so God can heal by miracle or medicine, or what I would like to say is that God can heal by miracle or miracle of medicine, that God can heal either way. And so can Jesus heal today? Does Jesus heal today? Does he always heal today? Not always. Not always. Not always does the story end like this, where the paralytic is going to get up and to walk. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. But this we can know with certainty, church, that in Christ, all chronic pain, depression, illness, infertility, disease, disability, all these things are real, but they're not forever. That one day our bodies will all be made new. Maybe not here in this lifetime, but in the next. And that's what Hebrews 11:1 is talking about, that we can have the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things unseen, that we can have the hope of new bodies on the other side of eternity. And so it's with that that we can cling to and we can have faith. And so Jesus says to him, he says, "Get up and take your bed and go home." And he rose, and immediately, verse 12, he picked up his bed and he went out before them. And they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this before." So he gets up. Can you imagine that? Not having strength in your legs and all of a sudden having movement in your legs, and stepping up and feeling strength that he hasn't had before. He gets up, and what does he do? He picks up his mat and he walks away. Why did he take his mat? Why did he take his bed? Isn't the bed represent his suffering? But now it represents his salvation. It doesn't just represent his past paralysis, but now it's a reminder of the power of Christ to save. Do we believe that Christ has the power to save? Do we believe that, church? We believe that. Do you believe it in your own life? Do you believe it not just in your mind, but do you believe it in the way that you live? Do you believe that Jesus Christ has the power to save your coworker, to save your spouse, to save your neighbor, to save your college roommate or the teammate that's on your sports team? Do you have the faith to believe? Oh, that God would give us faith to believe, a relentless faith to pursue those who are lost and those who need Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your cross. We thank you for the salvation that is available to each and every one of us. We thank you for the communion today where we had a chance to just reflect on that and the power to save us. But God, I pray that you would give us eyes to see those who are around us, that we wouldn't just be so caught up in serving our own needs, but you would give us eyes to see people who desperately need you. And God, would we make ourselves available to be used by you? God, we believe that you are mighty to save. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's stand in response.